Guys, a very warm welcome to my channel. This time we are going to analyze a company in a very new sector which we haven't covered on a channel until now, which is primarily the telecom infrastructure sector. And HFCL is a company which is a good play in this sector other than the major telecom players like Reliance or Bharti. So if you want to consider adding a stock in this sector in your portfolio and you don't want those large cap companies, then HFCL could be a good play for you in the telecom infrastructure sector. And with the 5G revolution coming into India, this sector would have a lot of tailwinds in the coming years, and this stock would be one which could give you that advantage by being a part of your portfolio. So if you're new to my channel, please do subscribe and hit the bell icon, and you can follow me on different social media handles as well. So let's get started. HFCL is not just a telecom product manufacturing company. They also provide solutions to telecom companies. They provide end-to-end product and services from product manufacturing of telecom equipments, as well as installation, implementation of various telecom infrastructure projects and maintenance of those projects post-installation. So it's an end-to-end service provider. It offers comprehensive solution to the telecom industry, and it is a tech-focused telecom products manufacturer. They just don't manufacture commoditized products, but their focus is on technology to develop new relevant products for their clients to keep up the pace with the latest technologies. As per their clients' request, they also customize and manufacture products for them. They also take up greenfield projects on the behalf of their clients, which is into CDMA and GSM networks, and also SATCOM communication, which is also a very niche and a very high growth sector in the coming years in India. Close to 25,000 plus installations they have done for the 2G and 3G cell sites, and 5G they are geared up to do more. They have laid more than 1 lakh kilometers of optic fiber cable in India. The company has more than 2,500 employees. And apart from the telecom sector, now they are entering or scaling up in different other sectors like railways, defense, and also the security sector. Coming to the production facilities, they have facilities in Himachal Pradesh, Goa and Chennai. Their corporate offices are there in Gurgaon and New Delhi. This company was originally started in 1980, but they entered into telecom business in 1987. They have 5 manufacturing facilities, and their production capacity is up to 18.5 million kilometers of optic fiber cable. So this is one of the largest optic fiber cable manufacturing facilities in India. They have 2 R&D centers, out of which one is recently established. The new R&D center is dedicated towards the 5G innovation in India. Now let's talk about the management of the company. The managing director and promoter is Mr. Mahendra Nahata. He is a BCom honors from Xavier's College, Kolkata, and he has been into the board of Reliance Infocom Limited in the past. So he has huge experience in the telecom industry. He was one of the pioneers of the new age telecom sector in India. He has been on the boards of IIT Bombay, Chennai and Allahabad, and he was the president of the Telecom Equipment Manufacturers Association of India. He has won the award of Telecom Man of the Millennium in Voice and Data in 2003. So by this candidature, you can understand his experience in the industry and his knowledge base of the product and the services rendered in this industry. Let's discuss brief milestones of the company. The company started in 1980, but they entered into the telecom business in 1987. In 1990s, they started benefiting by the liberalization of the Indian economy as well as the growth in the telecom sector. In the decade from 2000 to 2010, the company started growing organically and inorganically. And from 2010 to 20, the company focused on restructuring and making the company more efficient. They started expanding their manufacturing capacities by doing more and more capex, and they also expanded their product and service offerings. And now into the decade from 2020 to 2030, the company is completely geared up in terms of the production facilities, in terms of technology, to take the full advantage of the internet revolution in India as well as the 5G revolution. Let's talk about the business of the company. Major contributor of the company's business is the telecom sector. In the telecom sector, the company manufactures products like optic fiber cables. They have started manufacturing Wi-Fi products like routers and other communication equipments. They also manufacture high capacity radio relays, switches and various other products in the telecom infrastructure sector. Coming to the defense sector, the company manufactures products like night vision devices, electronic fuses, OFC optical transport network. So there are several complex products which the company manufactures for the defense sector, And as you know, India is investing more and more in their defense. So this also generates a lot of tailwinds for the company to work towards the defense products. Coming to the railways, as you know, Indian Railways is one of the biggest in the world. And now we are looking at modernizing the railway infrastructure as well as providing better facilities to the passengers. So you will nowadays see internet connectivity and various facilities at all the railway stations. And gradually, this will be provided to every nook and corner of the country. So as the railway infrastructure develops, this company will participate along with the other companies in getting this established by manufacturing products like passenger information display system, fiber optic transmission, CCTV video surveillance systems, and several other products. In the security and surveillance categories of products, the company manufactures video management systems, video analytics, automatic number plate recognition. This product also can be used in various applications, red light violation detection systems. So as you can see, the company is not manufacturing any simple commoditized products. They are manufacturing complex, niche and tech-enabled products for various industries in India and abroad. When you have a look at their customers, they have very big names. All the top telecom companies in India are their clients, like Jio, Airtel, Vodafone. Then big brands like Tata, Nokia, L&T are also their customers. Public sector undertakings like Bharat Electronics, BSNL are also their customers. So the company has a lot of marquee clients. Now let's talk about the industry in which the company operates. Broadly, the industry has a few trends wherein after COVID, we are giving more importance to the digitalization. Everybody is working from home. Everybody wants to adopt internet, latest technology, cloud infrastructure. So this digital era will create more and more demand for the products of this company. A lot of importance will be given going further to the data. The various companies make their decision based on the data analytics, and the companies require, and also at the personal level, we require faster communication through data, faster downloads and various advanced speeds. So all this will be possible only when the products of companies like HFCL are up to the mark. India is focusing on being self-reliant, Atmanirbhar. So the government is starting various PLI schemes to promote manufacturing of different products in India itself, so that our dependency on the foreign countries goes down and the Indian companies get more and more business. Another trend in this industry is digital and physical security. And the company is into products which are related to the security, for which a lot of demand will be generated in the coming times. The Indian telecom industry is at kind of an inflection point where we have widely used 4G now, and we are ready to move into the 5G revolution. The government for the 5G adoption is also starting various PLI schemes for the companies to manufacture those relevant products in India. There's another scheme by the government called Bharat Net Phase 2, where phase 1 is over. In this scheme, the government is trying to collect a lot of villages, lakhs of villages across India, even the remotest of the villages, through fiber optic communication, so that those villages also have internet connectivity and those villages also get exposure to the global opportunities. The government for the defense is trying to upgrade and make ourselves as good as any other economy in the world. Present, India has close to about 28 lakh kilometers of optical fiber network, and this network is planned to increase up to 50 lakhs by 2024. Modernizing the signaling and as well as the telecom infrastructure of the railways, the government is planning to spend close to about 55,000 crores. So this also will generate a lot of tailwinds for this company. Let's look at the internet subscription in India in terms of millions. If you see from FY16 to 21, it has grown from 343 million to 765 million subscribers in India. So that is at the speed at which the Indians are subscribing to internet connections. Now, along with the internet connections, the average data usage per user is also drastically increasing. In terms of megabytes per month, if you see from FY15, 805 megabytes per month, this simply means that the usage which one person does in 1 month. So 805 megabytes was the average usage in FY15, and now it has increased to 13,462 MB, which is close to more than 13 GB per person per month. So that is the amount of data which we are consuming through the internet every month. So the number of subscriptions are growing as well as the usage per person is growing drastically. In the last 6 years, it has grown at a CAGR of 76%. Can you imagine? So this is how internet is evolving in India, and that is generating massive tailwinds for this company. Who could be the competitors of this company? When it comes to the cable manufacturing, there will be several listed and unlisted players like Finolex, Polycab, RPG Cables, Sterlite Technologies, and various unlisted players. And coming to the telecom infrastructure also, there is a lot of competition from companies like Sterlite, GTL Infra, Tata Communications, Tejas Networks. And in defense sector, there could be competition from companies like Paras Defense, the public sector undertakings, Astra Microwave, Apollo Microsystems. So although the sector has good opportunities, but we cannot rule out competition for this company. What will be the competitive strengths of this company compared to the others? The company's management has more than 3 decades of experience in this industry. They are a tech-focused company. They have comprehensive offerings. Whatever the clients need, they are able to offer the entire range of products and services. They are able to install the projects. They are able to maintain those projects. They are trying to innovate new products. They have vertical integration of their facilities. They have dedicated research centers, including the new research center which they have set up for the 5G theme. A lot of big brands globally are their marquee clients. So this gives this company a competitive advantage compared to the others. What can be the growth outlook of this company in the next few years? As they have set up a dedicated 5G unit, they will have an edge over the other companies and they will focus more on the 5G business and generate more revenue. New R&D center also focuses on their new range of Wi-Fi products. They have set up a new plant which manufactures fiber to home cable in Hyderabad. They have participated through this wholly owned subsidiary in the government PLI scheme. They have started an aerospace and defense automotive wire harness facility. Their focus is to be a tech-driven company and not a commodity company. The company wants to increase the share of their products business in the total revenue gradually over a period of time to more than 60%. Some of the new products and technologies which the company is manufacturing is anti-drone technologies. They are focusing on smart coaches for the railways. For the fourth industrial revolution, they are focusing on advanced products for the various industries. The recent Wi-Fi manufacturing products range which they started, they have already shipped more than 1.5 lakh units of different products in this particular range until now. They have also participated in the government scheme of connecting various villages through the PM Vani scheme. What could be the different risks of this company? Their majority of the business is dependent on the telecom sector. So if there is a slowdown in this sector, the company's revenues could be drastically affected. There could be a lot of competition from the other companies. The company has to maintain the product quality and delivery timelines. Otherwise, their brand would get affected. Forex risk. The company has risk of technology. They have to keep up to date their technology of various products. And obviously, the company has to comply with various regulations of the government and other departments. Now, coming to the financial analysis, starting with the quarterly numbers, the revenues are close to 1122, close to 1100 crores in Q2 FY22 compared to the last year was about 1054. EBITDA has grown from 125 crores to 169 and profit after tax from 51 crores to 82 crores. So in terms of revenue as well as profitability, the company has seen a very decent growth compared to the same quarter last year. Margins have improved from 12 to 15% in EBITDA and 4.8 to 7.3% in terms of profit after tax. So there has been a margin expansion also. Now let's compare the 5 years figures. Starting with revenue, the company has grown at a CAGR of 20% revenue from FY 17 to 21, from 2031 crores to about 4423 crores. So the top line growth has been very impressive. Coming to EBITDA, it has grown at a CAGR of about 30%, but it has started on a low base of 187 crores in FY17. Even if we discount the 30% a bit, still the growth in EBITDA level is also very impressive. EBITDA margins have improved from close to 9% in 17 to 19 to now 12 to 13% range. Profit after tax has grown at a CAGR of 18% over the last 5 years, from 123 crores in FY17 to 239 crores in FY21. Coming to the balance sheet, the share capital has been constant except a few ESOP allotments done by the company. Reserves have steadily grown from 1000 crores to about 2000 crores in FY21. Borrowings are under control. The debt equity ratio is still 0.34 in spite of the company doing so much capex. It is at about 710 crores in September 2021. Trade payables have seen a steep rise from 815 crores in FY20 to close to 1750 crores, although they dropped down to about 1400 crores in September 21. So the company has to normalize these trade receivables, otherwise there could be an impact on their debt again. Fixed assets have steadily grown from about 200 crores to about 550 crores in September 21. Inventories are steadily rising, but this is in line with the company's revenue, so there's not a much concern. The trade receivables have moved up from 1182 crores to about 2200 crores in September 21. So the company has to maintain their trade receivables under control and they have to manage their working capital more efficiently. Debtor days have risen from 113 days in FY19 to close to 215 days. So this reflects that the company is taking more time to recover money from their customers, and this gradually has to get normalized in the range of 100 to 150 days for this company. The liquidity position of the company is fine. The cash equivalents are stable from about 132 crores to about 350 crores on the balance sheet as on September 21. Operating cash flows have been positive all the time, and the company has generated close to 57 crores of operating cash flows in FY21. Free cash flows sometimes have been negative because of the capex done by the company in FY19 and FY21. ROCE has improved from 13 to 18% in FY17-18 to close to 20 plus percent in the recent 3 years. So there has been margin expansion, the revenue has been growing well, as well as the return ratios have been improving. So the fundamentals of the company are improving over the last 5 years. The profit after tax margin is 7.3, slightly on the lower side, and let us see whether the company improves this into double digits going further. ROE is 13.5%, which can be further improved a little, close to 15 to 20%. Dividend yield is 0.19, though less, but still it's a dividend paying company. The remuneration to Mr. Mahindra Nahata is close to 5.7 crores, which is well within the limits as per the Companies Act. Coming to the shareholding pattern, the promoter stake is close to 42%, FIS DII is 0.63 and 4%. So the institutional stake is not very impressive, if public holds close to 53%. Reliance holds a stake of 3.76, which has increased to 5% in the recent QIP. The promoters have pledged their shares close to about 4.7%. So the shareholding pattern is not that impressive, as the promoter's stake is less than 50% and the institutional investments are not much in the company. Coming to the valuations, class rate price is close to 80, 52 week high and low is 21 to 95. In the last 5 years, the stock has given massive returns for its shareholders, close to 45%, 3 years 55%, last 1 year 230%. The market cap is close to 11,000 crores, face value is 1. And EPS is 2.62, which brings price to earning ratio to 32 times. Industry PE and the median PE in the last 5 years for the company is close to 17. So in terms of price to earnings, the stock is highly overvalued. The book value is rupees 15 and PB ratio comes to 5.32. So in terms of book value also, it looks expensive. Market cap to sales is 2.2 times, which is okay for a company like this. Let's look at the price chart. The stock has support at somewhere close to 68 rupees on a daily chart and close to 55 rupees. So someone who wants to invest in the company can take these levels as support and slowly accumulate the stock at 68 and 55 to begin with, and gradually on the downside, as in terms of valuation, the stock is highly overvalued at the present rate at which it is trading. So this is about HFCL. I hope you like the analysis, what we have done. To summarize, the company's management is very experienced in the industry. They have market leadership in some of the products which they manufacture and one of the highest capacities of optical fiber manufacturing. They are experts in the products which they manufacture and they have long-standing relationships with biggest clients across the globe. The company has shown consistent growth in the last decade and they are doing a lot of capex for the upcoming future and focusing on research and development and the new technologies. The fundamentals of the company are decent. And the Reliance Group is taking a lot of interest in increasing their stake in the company. The sector has a very bright future and will experience a lot of tailwinds from the private as well as the government viewpoint. But the company will face a lot of competition and their dependency majorly on the telecom sector could be a risk where there could be a slowdown in the sector affecting the company. In terms of valuations, the stock is overvalued. So you have to be very careful and gradually accumulate the stock at the lower levels. So thank you for watching this video. I hope you like it. If you like it, hit the like and subscribe button and press the bell icon to get notification of all my new videos. If you want me to analyze your favorite company, don't forget to comment the name of that company in the comment. I will surely consider one of those options in the upcoming videos. So thank you for watching and have a great, wonderful day.